Very loud TSM chance during them on as well. Counter Logic Gaming, high damage, a lot more of their roles. They should have a pushing bot lane as well. And we'll see if CLG can get the same lane advantage as they did in game one. It looks like they're going to need it.
Absolutely, and I'm glad this has gone to a third game, Freak. You want as much TSM versus CLG as possible. They only meet twice per split, so it's great to see when they go the distance.
Three times they're lucky in playoffs, and maybe we'll get even more as time wears on. Of course, keep in mind, if you missed the interview heading into the game, there is a bet on the line between the team owners, Hotshot GG and Reginald. Whoever loses must get the enemy team logo tattooed on his face for a week. That's a pretty temporary tattoo. It's not, you know, it's not ink under the skin, but still a good bet.
Personally, I feel like that's a pretty lame bet.
Really?
I feel like I heard some of the things they're talking about earlier, like you have to cook him a meal or like a servant for a day, and those sounded cooler to me. But, I mean, face tattoos are one thing, but when it's temporary, they say a week, you're going to wash that off like 2 days later.
I mean, I feel like making eggs for Reginald is way less embarrassing than wearing a TSM logo on my face. Just in general. Just not even as part of a bet. Just,
fair enough.
You know, life choices wise. Who would put a TSM logo on their face? I'm kidding. I love you, TSM fans. I'm sorry.
Nice save.
Yeah, nice save. I'm just kidding. Equally, you know, scary to do it for any other team in the NALCS. I just like to rag on TSM fans because so many of them.
Hmm. Always fun to make as many people dislike you as possible.
Yeah. That's my road of going with things, just have as much anger as possible in the world.
Size cats, TSM.
Yeah, I hate cats. I hate Infernal Drake. Yeah. I don't actually hate TSM. I'm kidding. I'm sorry. But we are into this game, of course. I'm sorry for derailing the conversation. Svenskeren, shifting up his jungle route, actually, starting on Wolves. I like the idea of just doing different things. In pro play, players will research you. And if you have habits, they will abuse them. I like making small adaptations. Sometimes it will pay off in very advantageous ways.
But the biggest thing that happened for this one is that he had the ward on the blue buff of Xmithie, so he knows he can just do the Ivern thing and quickly go and steal red buff. What will be interesting is if Xmithie, since he had a ward on Svenskeren's red, is just going to end up doing some vertical jungling and moving up towards red, because that would be the standard play.
It would be. You're going to see he's pinging that I'm going back to my own camp right there. And the thing is, actually, in looking at Ivern games in general, I've had a bit of experience with this myself. If you're opposing, like, Lee Sin, gets a leech from his dual lane, he clears the camp so fast, he catches you at the buff anyway. But Xmithie, of course, taking a slower route, walks through and says, oh, yeah, oh, it's gone. All right.
Yep, bad guess. That means you're three buffed. The reason he had to guess here is because even though they knew that Ivern didn't start on red, that didn't mean that Svenskeren couldn't just start tapping the blue buff and then walk over to smite the red later. And by the time that would have happened, the ward would have expired. So Xmithie is guessing either way which red buff Ivern is going to go to. Mm-hmm. Svenskeren guessed right, and that's how it feels to play against Ivern.
Yeah, it's sometimes very difficult. You pretty much can't win a smite fight. He smites for infinite damage on any general camp right there. And there's the third buff completed. Sven can feel good about that. Level 3, Xmithie takes a scuttle. And really, you can't fight him back for it.
Now also,
situation known.
Notice the brush maker in the brush. You wouldn't think that's a great usage of it, but it does grant temporary vision. So he was potentially able to spot out Xmithie when he did that.
Bjergsen over the wall. Smithy not to follow, but that is at least a couple hundred mana out of Bjergsen's pool. Smithy makes him. I mean, he was visible anyway. There's not really much lost looking at the gank. He doesn't need to stay in Fog of War. The junglers saw each other regardless. CLG, of course, with their lane assignments, have very good pushing pressure. Sivir and Karma, two of the very best lane pushers. Darshan down, a little bit of farm, but not terrible. And actually, a really nice hook, actually. Puts Hanser in a bad way. A couple hundred HP advantage. Smithy clears out the camps.
Jungle fight!
Well, it's double up in a level advantage. Feels good to get the stun.
Yeah, not much of a fight. Always able to get that early lead. With Ivern, one of the things we mentioned, how the jungle became more difficult for many, except for Ivern.
Well, Darshan.
Fight's getting a little bit dicey.
And he's going to hook in. Here we go. Into the octagon. The damage is there. 300 HP versus 150. Cooldown's up in 8 seconds.
They both have Flash.
Flash E. Hooked up in 5. And Svenskeren just goes, all right, we're cool.
Yep. Well, Darshan went for it. Still down in CS, though. Hanser.
I think he made the lane
the best
though.
Of that. Yeah, they're both going to TP back here, and Svenskeren can help shove this in, which is actually going to be kind of necessary.
Yeah, now Darshan, I don't know if you actually saw Sven. I don't know if you saw him in the root when he went over towards the Krugs, but...
And he's been playing pretty aggressive, no flash.
Double root's gonna be there. Now, can he get the anchor drops onto the wall? They're gonna try to body block it. Looks like Darshan doesn't have a way of doing so.
They get him.
Perfectly played. TSM remove the escape route. The attacks are there. Brushmaker for the auto attacks, and there's first blood coming through. Nicely done, Svenskar, making the gank happen.
And Darshan gonna lose that big wave as we see the team owners down at the bottom of the screen. Big start there for Hanser and Svenskaren, and Darshan getting aggressive. Losing a huge amount of experience.
Ooh, losing a huge amount of HP as well as Stixxay, a nice hook. Turned around decently enough. But yeah, I gotta say, very big things to the TSM top side. Worth pointing out, CLG doing famously in bot lane, up 10 minions right now, and Smithy, maybe not the most beautiful trade, but it's gonna get some meaningful damage. Shouldn't be in danger anymore, but at least is able to acquire the farm that Darshan lost.
Yeah, really just trying to get as much experience as possible because he was set back early on in the game. We're going to watch this one more time, though. Svenskaren just looping around. Darshan used his flash previously, and he had just teleported back. This is the most punishing time to gank a top laner is after they've already used their teleport to get back to lane. Red buff, as well as that last Brushmaker, keeps it continually applied. Hanser's able to finish it with the Arcane Smash, and then that entire wave is experience lost for Darshan.
That's pretty brutal for him. Now Svenskaren, ooh, 60 would not expect this.
Well, he's got a spell shield, so might just turn for Afro.
He's gonna get the slow at the very least, and now point blank on Afromu. Hook's gonna land. It's gonna be quite a bit of damage. All the CC they need, not even a chance to get away. Afromu did not flash away from the point blank route, and that's 2-0 for TSM yet again. Smithy pushed out of the river by Bjergsen, who's himself up 5 minions, and TSM off to the same lead they had in game 2.
Yeah, and I like the way Svenskaren ganked right there, and it's how you should be ganking on Ivern, is you actually just walk up to them with your shield, hoping to get the slow, and only then do you cast your Root Caller, because otherwise it's too slow of a skill shot and it's easily dodgeable. Afromu should have flashed it based on the cast animation, but failed to do so.
Yeah.
And then once he was rooted from that, it was chained with the death sentence, and they burst him down.
And that was well executed by the rest of TSM this time around. The skill shots landed. Once again, a fight in the top lane. Level 6 for Hanser. Doesn't use the ult for the damage, just gonna punch the opponent back and forth, and you can see Darshan having to use cooldowns for retreat. Not something he wants, as the blues will be handed back and forth. Bjergsen gets to feel good about a blue buff steal.
Yeah. And this could be pretty substantial, because Svenskaren's probably going to be able to refresh this blue buff for Bjergsen. Or if Xsmithy actually tries to invade in, they don't have the point of power in this game to do so. He's not yet level 6, only halfway to it. Meanwhile, Svenskaren's level 6, and Bjergsen would be able to collapse over the wall with full mana. So I can see Xsmithy wanting to go for it, but I don't think he's going to be able to.
Speaking of not being able to, CLG can't stay in the river anymore. A quick ward to spot if the dragon's going to go down later, but it is TSM living inside the jungle of Counter Logic Gaming. The brush, the wards, and aggressive control ward there as well, and makes life real difficult. There you go, Brushmaker lets him know. Yep, Smithy's right over there. He's got to be afraid as he kites the camp down and kills it and as much of the pocket ward as he can. Finally able to evolve his claws and feels a bit better about this one. Okay, so 1,500, 1,300 the gold lead TSM. CLG can work back from this, but it's been very good work out of both Hanser and Svenskaren making these plays happen. Sven really making both of these kills so far. Man of this game, at least for the first 8 minutes.
Yeah, gonna scale up in a very supportive sense. I feel like Ivern's strongest point of the game is with Redemption as well as Locket. Huge amount of mid game team fight power. And they're gonna have the rest of their damage hopefully come through from the Azir and the Jhin later. Unlike CLG, who's gonna be hoping for Xsmithy to be a damage threat later in the game.
Mm-hmm. Looks pretty good right there. Now a red buff on a Hanser, of course, one of the strengths of Ivern. You get to share free buffs with people, and it takes them like 10 total seconds to grab it. Red buff does give health regen when out of combat, so it's going to mean full HP for Hanser all the time, in addition to his true damage that he can apply with auto attacks.
It's actually a huge amount of power, being able to double buff like that. Also, this is the first real Ivern we've seen in NA, so I'm going to keep throwing out Ivern facts. You just throw the brush on the Drake, and then the enemy team just can't see it. So it makes it so hard to lifesteal. Like, if they had a ward in the pit, once he's in that brush, you just Drake disappears, so you have no idea how to throw in skills to steal it.
Literally can't spite.
Save it.
Yep.
Easy Drake.
And that's nicely done. Mountain Drake gonna be good in the late game. Doesn't mean too much right now, but And you take what you can get, absolutely, TSM. Very little resources were required for that. And a nice spell shoot by Six, but look at the damage up, but you can see there's the reason they picked this Karma Sivir lane. They're still up minions as a result, even after the kill came through onto Aphromoo a while ago. But just not the same power for Svensgaren ganking the way he has been. Xsmithy individually, and actually down gold 300 under Svensgaren, which you'd expect based on the assist count. Otherwise, keeping pace aside from the fact that buffs have been getting stolen away.
Absolutely, and just look at how fast this lane can shove the Sivir Karma. Props to COG to reaching back to this lane, since most have just completely bought into the Jhin Varus Ashe game, but the Sivir Karma, even if they're not going for the lethality rush, can just shove out a lane like Jhin and Thresh. There's no way Jhin and Thresh can shove as fast, so Stixxay just able to try and keep the map pressure up, and that's the best part of the map for CLG right now. Even though they had the death, just being able to keep the map pressure there could lead to some rotations. I wonder when they're going to be going for that turret push.
Creator counter, but suddenly it's 2v1. No fair, Darshan! Outnumbered in this fight. Huhi helping out with a shield. And looks like they're just going to walk away as the cupcake touting Daisy is just going to freeze frame for a second. Popping and locking as you will.
Uh-oh. Oh,
looks for the big play, knocks him right back in. There's a shockwave. Here comes a CC chain. And it's going to be a stun landing on a Bjergsen. Nothing else to do as the team runs for dear life. There's the quick flay back in, though. Biofrost wants to make this happen. More crowd riddle. Daisy goes down. Xsmithy has something to say about the jungle choices. One casualty for TSM. Poor Daisy.
Yeah, that's doesn't count as a kill, unfortunately. No. The 50 gold instead of the 300 and, or 450 plus assists. And that will give Stixxay some time on the bottom side, but it also gives Haunter a lot of time on the top side. Darshan falling dangerously far behind. I mean, he was lower level than Ivern while running into him in the jungle right there. So COG investing a fair bit to try and get something happening there, and really nothing doing.
Yeah, nothing just yet. It's just lane pressure from the bot side, and the turret's getting low. If they can get Huhi and Smithy to roam down, they can probably four-man that turret, as long as they don't lose top lane first. But top lane is down to half, and Svensgaren wants to be part of the party. Suddenly it's a 2v1, and Darshan has to give us a little bit of respect. Gives it enough to not die.
Yeah.
But it's only a matter of time before those turrets start falling in the pressured lanes.
Really feel like Svensgaren did that because he had nothing else to do. Ivern's turret diving is pretty weak since he has such low damage, but he does want to stop Xsmithy from taking that blue. Can't quite get there.
Well, something bright now for CLG. Three top lane, doesn't turn into anything. And back they go to their assorted lanes. I do, again, still want to see it. On the aggressive side, I feel like CLG, bot lane is their point of pressure, and they're normally very good at getting first turret. See if they can make that happen here.
Yeah, they've been able to chip the turret fairly substantially. And with all the jungle tomfoolery up in this top lane, it's drawing attention away. Haunter's going to try and kill Xsmithy here.
Oh, flash play is going to land. Spell shield, not going to get him out of the box. Ignite is on, a few more autos to do a good exhaust, but Turtle can flash auto, not quite gonna find it. Actually flashed it down anyway, but Darshan is now with the teleport. Does have the hook, does not have the ulti though. Biofrost actually gonna dodge away from Q, but now where's he gonna go? There's no spells available. That means a shockwave turns into a double kill. Counterlogic Gaming finally on the board. That's who he found a way to get out of his lane. And that's going to be bot lane first turret, you've got to assume, almost for sure on CLG's favor.
Yeah, and that play backfires in a huge way for TSM because it's an incredibly risky play to flash forward like that when you have no teleport in your top laner and no assistance coming anywhere on the map. So unless this play instantly kills, it's only going to backfire for TSM because no one else on their team can help them. So Barfrost gets the flay, but they can't lock him down with any other CC. And then because of the exhaust, Wild Turtle decides to go back, but CLG matches with teleport. They end up not even getting the first turret, and now Haunter might go down.
They did get first turret. This was just a traded kill, but yes, it's going to be Xsmith. Oh, sorry. CLG gets first turret. Yeah. I misunderstood you. You're right. First turret, CLG. TSM got one answered. And of course, that solo kill by Xsmithy means Counter Logic Gaming have tied up the gold within 300.
Yeah, just strategically, if you're looking at a big picture, it was really poor choice by TSM because the one lane that is strongest for COG is the place TSM tries to even number duel without the ability to match, and that only strengthens that bottom lane even more and pulls COG right back into the game.
That's got to be heartening for the CLG fans and CLG players, and oh, that's a hook on an Aphromoo. Into the root collar, into the flay, a quick shield from Huhi keeps him just barely alive, but not long enough. Redemption doesn't come down in time. Actually, it was Bile. No, it was. Sorry, it was Svenskeren's redemption. It turned red, and I was like, wait, Bjergsen doesn't have one. Svenskeren would have killed him even if Bjergsen didn't. Nicely played there, TSM, to find the pickoff in the in the river.
Yeah, extra supports in the game. And yeah, that's just, once again, Svenskeren going with that max Q increases the root duration and allows more time for Biofrost to match with the Death Sentence. That inbuilt synergy could actually be why he's going for the max Q, because the wind-up time as well as the travel time on the Q, if you only put one point in Root Caller, the weakened duration, you could flash out of it. But now, if they land the Root Caller, it's a pretty much a guaranteed Death Sentence if Biofrost is in range.
Literally at that point, because they got the kill picked off, and DSM finding more to do as they've knocked down bot lane outer turret as well, and that was the site of all of CLG's power, but you kill off the support, not there in lane anymore, and suddenly more being gained. Bjergsen getting an effortless blue buff as well. CLG not really pushing into mid lane at all themselves. Looking for top lane ward control. They've got a couple, actually. Looks like pulling around this top jungle will be CLG's next big play. And that might mean they're forsaking Cloud Drake, as they have not put any wards on that side of the map to fight TSM for it.
Absolutely, in this game at a pretty pivotal point. Drake stacking could be a big thing, and they're really just trying to make their map movements around the map as everyone... Map movements into lanes.
Sure.
As no one is fully scaled up in items yet. Nashor's Tooth obviously good for Azir, but I feel like that's weaker when compared to the Morellon Omicron and Sorcerer's Shoe Spike of Orianna. But once again, we have that mismatch of the Djinn being at the items he wants. Sivir, not quite there yet.
Yeah, Sivir feels good at BF Sword and then gets progressively worse until you're about 35 minutes into the game. And you're right now kind of troughing a bit as the Serrated Dirk is in. That's just more icing on the cake, which is fitting when you've got Candy Cane Ivern here. But look at all this control. TSM revealing the brush, walking in and taking over this left side of the map. And, you know, battling for the same sorts of areas that CLG was. Nice move by Hu. He actually wins that trade and gets some good poke down. Of course, Sork Shoe is really effective against someone who's not building any more magic resist. Bjergsen will have to give some level of respect, but suddenly it's a four-man mid lane push, and he's got to run pretty fast away from this one. They will pick off Daisy. Isolated makes that easy. More shots into Smithy. Pull the rest of the team in. Darshan here on the sides to reinforce. 4v4 is called off.
Yeah, a relatively effective defense there by CLG. It is hard when Ivern walks into tank the turret and the rest of the team moves in. They got poked pretty hard by the Djinn ultimate, and TSM's going to try and rush down this Cloud Drake, which, by the way, CLG will not be able to assault. They have no ways of getting a ward on it unless they go in for a full fight.
There's not going to be much chance. The W, not going to land it. It was a nice attempt, but it's still a very secured smite. CLG were unable to put pressure onto Bjergsen. He was 1v4 in the mid lane while that Drake was going in and really not affected by anything. Even putting in the dance moves. Love it, Bjergsen. Emperor still got his groove.
Oh yeah, really good wave clear on that Azir. Can often survive those odd-numbered situations as well. Most good Azirs as well keep a soldier in their pocket in case someone comes for them so they can escape.
Shockwave and isolation. One more hit would kill him off, and he has to flash away, but that is double summoners down for Bjergsen. A great shockwave by Huhi, but does it turn into anything as that minion wave is basically gone.
Yeah, and really close. As we mentioned, having that last soldier able to cast as Bjergsen is able to slide away with his flash. Not before Huhi pegged him with the shockwave, though, so a little bit more AP if Bjergsen doesn't build up any of that magic resistance. That will turn into a kill later.
And of course, Blasting Wand does not turn into Abyssal Scepter, so it looks like it's not yet in the works for Bjergsen. Might be a little bit longer. Smithy to battle for Scuttlecrab. Vision is nice, although we really don't expect to see Rift be going down. Just a bit of river control, while Toto just collecting wave in the top side, and again, the CLG just sort of saying, okay, we picked off the mid laner, we made him recall. Let's just shove waves and recall ourselves and reset. So CLG have yet to find their aggressive moves here. Instead, it's going to be TSM looking for a bit more. Smithy's got to jump this wall. He will do so, but he's taking even more damage. That's his ultimate down as an escape tool. TSM back on the siege from mid lane. Good damage in a 6A.
Yeah, just trying to get as much damage on this turret as possible with the poke. Second time's a charm.
Not good for Smithy. That's going to be the kill picked up. Hanser grabs it under the turret. Basically invincible, and TSM opened it up even farther. 3 turrets to 1, 4 kills to 3, 2,000 gold up.
Yeah, was ready to compliment X-Smithy for his hop over the wall since he hasn't evolved. It's actually a pretty tricky move. Then he just sticks around and gets hooked one more time to lead to the kill, and TSM going to try and take a lot off of that.
All right, well, I guess they can grab the Rift Toyotas. There's no outer turrets left to kill off, and they said, well, 320 minutes, I guess we'll grab this after all. They've got to kill it in like 25 seconds or it will despawn, but that's more than enough time for them. Ivern, of course, great at killing those things off. Daisy's a good tank, so is Maokai, and Ponser is delivered extra split push power. in a matchup he was already winning substantially.
Exactly, watching this one more time. They have the Thresh and the Ivern in the brush, but the vision is there since the turret is close enough to it, so not many excuses for Xsmithy, just kind of trapping himself up against the wall and not giving him juke opportunities. Falls pretty easily.
Good pickup then, TSM. As we know, growing their lead, and they really were able to snowball properly earlier on. See what more they can get for themselves. This is the harder part of shot calling. You're 20 minutes in, you know your opponents have wave clear, it's two-item Sivir, it's two-item Orianna. Outer turrets are already dead. This is actually where it gets a bit more difficult. Do you risk the super early Baron attempts? That's hard to do. There's no Drakes to kill, so Tier 2 is just are difficult, and you gotta see how TSM can push a game where they're not winning by as much. It's only 2,000. It's within comeback range, easily.
Yeah, and Stixxay is starting to build up towards those items he really needs to hit once he gets his Infinity Edge. That's it for Sivir as far as strong team fights go. But we also have to keep in mind that strength point for Ivern right now. Locket, as well as Redemption. Incredibly hard for CLG to finish kills if Thresh and Ivern are there, just to the repeatable shielding. And Wild Turtles at that strong power spike with the Edge of Night and the Ghost Blade. So it's tricky for CLG to pull off any plays, and TSM almost wants them to try something so they can turn it around with shields and then a Maokai flank.
It's really worth pointing out how especially effective Wild Turtle is. Darshan's been buying Magicka's for his landing phase, which means the Lethality is more effective than it normally is against what would be a tank, but not really that against Wild Turtle. Yeah, it pops in at the beginning, looks at the chase into Darshan. One more hit will knock him in the air. She's going for it.
Hey!
Oh, he's airborne. And back on the ground. All right, that was fun.
Well, they're going to keep dancing here. Hunter's still looking for a flank. And there goes Darshan.
Flats in Shockwave out of three of them. What a beautiful opening. Do they have the damage? Xsmithy push right back out, but the health bars are low. They're trying to pick him off, but Stixxay actually falls to the tank. But two more turn back around. Wild Turtle gets a trade. It's a 2-for-2 death so far. 3-3 on the map. Darshan with the chase in. Finds the anchor toss. Wild Turtle can't quite get the kill, and it's a 3-2 lead. Make that. I can't get a monster. Turns away a bit early. CLG walked away with a +1 kill on this one. And can they find more on a Hanser? He is invincible.
He is a little tanky right now, and they no longer have an AD carry, but that fight was about as perfect of his initiation as CLG could hope for as they get the three-man shockwave. And even with that, it's nearly a 3-for-3 as Hanser continues to try and be a nuisance.
Nuisance he is. That, he's still not losing HP. That was actually just nothing happened to him. He gets damage reduction when he's alone. And
yeah, and we mentioned the difficulty of finishing kills on TSM, so even with a three-man shockwave onto Biofrost, Bjergsen, and Svenskeren, the Redemption comes down and the Locket Shield absorbs. And all the while that's happening, Haunter is executing Stixxay on the backside. So yes, CLG do win the fight thanks to their good initiation, but it is not by much. Wild Turtle burning the flash in a straight line into the dredge line, not that great.
Yeah.
But Xsmithy able to escape on the backside, can't get finished off by Haunter.
Great play by CLG. The engage was awesome, but I gotta give props to Haunter and Turtle for just somehow salvaging two kills out of the situation. They probably didn't deserve to get anything in there, but those two made big plays. Now the root is on. Who he gonna get? Grab Shockwave slows down Biofrost, but it's not gonna be enough. Bjergsen getting the kill credit on this one. TSM find another opening. Hots just walking in for a flank.
Yeah, pretty straightforward play there, but it is started by the map pressure. And this is a pretty mean siege when they have the Ivern Brush right if they want to fall back. Makes it even harder to push up for. And with no Orianna, it's an easy turret take.
No chance for the defense. Down that one goes. TSM stretches the gold lead 3,000 now, this one. Bigger than it was before, absolutely. 4-1 in turret. CLG haven't been able to find a whole lot for themselves. Just that one team fight that only went +1. TSM now second Mountain Drake, going to be great for closing out games. Looks real solid here.
And this is a pretty good Drake for this TSM team composition to have. Ivern being able to black out the vision while taking objectives creates an even larger sense of urgency when trying to collapse into a team. And then having the Azir with the Mountain Drakes only increases how quickly they can threaten objectives like Baron. So it's going to make it almost a necessity for CLG to kind of blindly charge in if they don't want to cede objectives. And that's what TSM wants, because they have great zone control through the Azir, really good shielding and counter engage from the Ivern and the Thresh. And that also will expose COD's backline to Maokai flanks. So I think TSM is quite happy about getting that second Mountain Drake.
Gotta feel really good here. TSM, a pretty secured composition. They've got a lot of tools here, and it's always, I feel, easier to navigate heavy frontline compositions because you know you can dive anything you want once you're ahead. Ponser can pretty much take any fight he wants, and it's never going to turn bad for him. TSM definitely feeling good here, and yeah, it's just they've got to keep riding it out here with a 3,000 gold lead. Ponser split pushing towards the bot side of the map. The rest of the team looking to get control. Be a bit near top side as they're starting to push through this side of the river. Kind of Legend Gaming have to give a lot of respect to the fact their wards are dead, and look at these control wards. It means Baron can be opened up right now with Daisy tanking.
Daisy tanks. COG can't see it is the biggest thing right here. So they would have to just jump in for a teamfight, and they got to do it fast.
It's enough to pull TSM away. Here's the flank that was found. Darshan with a teleport. The frontliner's there. Can they get the shockwave?
They got
Wild Turtle. That's huge. Now how about the rest of this fight? Because Bjergsen is still alive. Wild Frost low. Redemption buys some time. But Stixxay once again is frontlining and loses his life. Bjergsen down to 200 HP. It's 2-for-1 so far in favor of CLG. Darshan does not have flash yet, but he can still catch Svenskeren, who's not that durable without his ultimate alive. And it's going to be, ooh, a nice dodge on the hook. And Hanser gets away with that one. Only plus one CLG. Can they get any more? But Hanser, just too durable on the front lines.
Yeah, and they were able to get the shockwave onto Wild Turtle, which is so critical. We were kind of talking about the stacked advantage the TSM would have, but where they are vulnerable is the low amount of magic resistance on Bjergsen, which is none, and just the edge of none on Wild Turtle if he gets tagged by something like the shockwave. So once again, CLG gets a very ideal initiation onto a very difficult team to fight, but they just get a plus one kill once again.
And that's just got to be heartbreaking that CLG, I feel like if TSM weren't piloting these fights that much better, CLG be like, oh man, we got 3-for-0. We can end the game like happened in game one. This time around, TSM fighting back off some really crucial engages.
Yeah, so good on CLG to not hesitate with the initiation, knowing that Baron will be a threat. They actually focus Daisy early on, which is good because the sustained knockups in fights is huge. But then it's just tricky to finish off the rest of the kills. Bjergsen able to keep them away with the Emperor's Divide. They keep the Ivern Shield going, and then they're unable to finish off any kills. And they actually look back to Baron, continuing trying to force his play. Nothing doing.
And Smithy almost found Bjergsen in the wings with that one. Jumped in, got the isolated Q, but Bjerg was able to jump over the wall. 3-0-1. Void Staff now done means if he does stay alive in fights, he can just eviscerate frontline. Even the Hex Drinker of Smithy will not stand up long. But COG feel like they are the team with the advantage. Void Staff going to be next for who he will mean. He'll be even better at picking people off, but that mid lane not going to fall just yet. COG still cannot buy a turret.
Yeah, it's so hard for them to push in this matchup. I mean, Darshan falling 60 CS behind, and part of that is just from side wave manipulation. It's usually Hanser who has the freedom to go to that side wave and keep them pushing, and it's denying a lot of CS on the side of COG.
Well, we'll see if CLG can actually make this happen. I think back to their set against Cloud9 last week, where it's like, ooh, CLG is actually playing up against a team who's got, you know, 3 wins so far in matches. Like, maybe they can actually do what it takes and beat a number one team. And they couldn't quite close out game 3 against Cloud9. Cloud9 outshot called them. Here they are against TSM in a game that is very clearly winnable. And you're seeing those glimmers of good plays. Those shockwaves are great. And now again, a hook comes in, but Darshan is tanky. Still hasn't broken through the shield. Smithy might be knocked up soon. And it focuses on to Daisy Svensker and dropped a bit low as well. Big shield comes out. Shockwave catches two. Here comes the frontline damage up, but Darshan's got to run away. He's running out pretty rapidly. Hanser can't let pick off the kill just yet as another shield comes through. Redemption puts even more health in, but CLG Feisterkite back. Biofrost picked off by Hui, but look at the kills coming back around. Smithy getting a bit low. Over the wall comes Hanser. That could be another one picked off as he tries to take down. And look, the knockback on a stick. Say the damage is there. Bjergsen still staying alive. The 3 fights in a row with 100 HP left on him. And Darshan just going to be picked off as well. A triple in for Wild Turtle, who stayed alive the whole way through. 4-for-1 TSM. That's going to be Baron again.
Yeah, and a solid front-to-back team fight there by TSM. The main turning point is when Huhi went in to finish the kill onto Biofrost, but fell himself. That meant TSM had one true threat to worry about after that, which was Stixxay, and Bjergsen was able to go in for that kill. We're gonna watch this one more time as TSM also gets to start it on the tank of Darshan and not overextend for these kills. They just stay on Darshan, keep Ponser in the front line with as much tank as possible. He's not getting touched. The shockwave doesn't hit the back line this time, which is again advantage TSM. And they stay back through the Nautilus ultimate and move forward slowly with tanks in front. Watch who he here though, as he goes in for that kill.
Immediate hook.
But death sentence, as it's the dying breath, that's one threat down. Bjergsen sees Stixxay over the wall, goes for the shot backwards as Turtle is picking up a kill on the Kha'Zix over the wall as well. And just a strong Well played team fight there by TSM as they pick up the final kill on the backside.
He's like, ah, I came so close. He actually nearly got that kill onto Bjergsen as well. 6A himself, only a couple hundred gold away from Infinity Edge being done. If that comes through, maybe that fight looks a bit different and he picks the Emperor off. But it's TSM, 7,000 gold in the lead. Smithy making the best of a bad situation. Will be taking this break down. That's a bit nice for them, but still a long way to go. Bjergsen now blue elixir in, means he can eviscerate these turrets. Woo! Attack speed. TSM wrecks the gold lead even farther. 8,000 up, another Emperor turret up. And
yeah.
TSM can lick the closest one out, we think.
Azir no longer able to just press W on turrets for the big chunk, but that doesn't mean he can't attack it extremely fast for large amounts of damage. And that's what TSM can hope to do here with now a 7,000 gold lead, is just keep the wave spread out, chip down the outer turrets, and force CLG into some tough initiations, as TSM is ahead in a lot of important ways. The Infinity Edge is done for Stixxay, but at this point, it's up against a 200-plus armor Maokai, and he needs a Lord Dominic's Regards to cut through.
Big brush wall up. Now come the rotation to the mid lane, and TSM using this Baron buff for as much power as they can. Daisy just tanky in the front line. Even that's able to walk away after the shield's timeout. TSM break one of the turrets.
And to call back to COG Sears against C9 last week, COG is showing these glimpses, but it's not going to show up in the standings unless they're actually able to close out these series. Take one game off C9. They've taken one game off TSM, but they can't get that second one. They would actually walk away from this at 1-4. It's a very discouraging start to the split.
It is discouraging. Again, you can argue strength of schedule. TSM and C9, maybe the two best teams in NALCS right now, but still not pretty. Looking at a little bit more here in this one. They're going to catch up to Smithy. The hook's going to land. Beautiful by Biofrost, and a few more shots will do him in. Root Call is going to get there yet again, and that's the final shot coming through. Wildcutter picks off the CLG jungler. TSM hoping to improve to 4-1 with this match win. It looks like it's going to be likely Darshan rooted again. Wild Turtle locking him in place. And another kill going to be in the works. There's that picked up. 2-0 so far. Huhi running away, but not going to run fast enough. Turtle with yet another one picked up. That's four kills already in 6A alone inside the fountain. Isn't going to do enough. TSM will cement the comeback in the series. TSM improved to 4-1. And Hotshot GG is going to have a TSM logo on his face as TSM wins the match.
And they just walked through CLG in that final team fight. The Ivern shield spam on Maokai made the Nexus turrets completely a non-factor, and CLG was unable to cut through anyone in that 5-0 final team fight.
Beautifully played, TSM, ending the game. Hanser up just 8 shy of 100. Farm over Darshan. Ekav, Sven scaring up levels as well. Bjergsen still not dying. And there were razor-thin margins in this game. A 32-minute victory is on the fast side of average, but Bjergsen was under 200 HP in a team fight at least 4 times this game, where they nearly picked him off with a shockwave. They nearly got him off with one more auto attack from Stixxay, and those